Writing a good study design. People often confuse themselves, case control, cohort, prospective, retrospective, observational, experimental, and they tend to write inappropriate study designs. Today we'll try to give clarity on certain terminologies used in study design and also a simple algorithmic approach to arrive at a proper study design. First important terms to differentiate are observational study versus interventional study or experimental study. So in an observational study, as a researcher, you will be a simple bystander allowing the things to happen in their own course, and you will simply record certain parameters and do the analysis and come to some conclusions. Whereas in case of intervention study, you will not allow the things to happen in their own course. You will intervene. How do you intervene? By giving a tablet or by giving an injection or by doing a surgery or even intervening by giving simple health education to stop smoking or to do physical activity or to eat something, not to eat something. Even that is a intervention. But there is a small hitch here. There is a thin line between these observational intervention studies in certain kinds of situations. For example, for hernia in your hospital, there are two interventions available. Two different kinds of mesh are being used. Both are already approved treatments, and you are using the mesh based on the cost and the patient preference or the consultant's preference. You are not doing any kind of random selection of patients into these two treatment groups. But over a period of time, you are collecting outcome data on these two different surgical methods, and then you are trying to compare them. There, the intervention is being done, but not as a part of your research study. It is being done as a part of the hospital treatment protocol. That is considered as an observational study, not an intervention study. So you have to understand this thin line. Otherwise, observational study, you are simple bystander observing things, not intervening. Whereas in case of intervention study, you are trying to actively intervene and change the natural course of occurrence of events. Hope I am very clear. The second important terminology you should look at is descriptive versus analytical. Very simple. Descriptive means it is a single group study. You have only one study group. There is no comparative group. If there is a comparative group, either one or two or more than two comparative groups, then it is called as an analytical study. Another important terminology is cross-sectional, prospective, retrospective. This terminology is based on the direction of the study. For example, I am taking a group of diabetic population and I am assessing the proportion of them having depression. I am not following them forward in time, I am not following them backward in time. At instantaneous point of time, I am looking at how many of these diabetic patients are having clinical depression using some HAM-D scale. So this is called a cross-sectional study where you are not looking back or forward. In a second scenario, I am taking a group of diabetic patients. I am following them forward in time for next 5 years or 10 years. So I am starting my study in 2020. I am following them forward in time for next 5 years till 2025. And I am assessing the incidence of stroke among this population. So this is called a prospective study where my starting point is 2020 and the event is happening in 2025. My outcome is happening in the future. I am following them forward in time. There is another kind of study where it is a retrospective study. I am starting my study in 2020. I am looking at the association between childhood obesity and diabetes mellitus in the adult population. I am taking a group of diabetic population now in 2020. And I am looking back in time and I am assessing how many of these people were obese during their adolescence or childhood. So here my outcome is diabetes. It has already happened in 2020. The person is diabetic and I am looking backward in time for some risk factor which has happened in the past. So the terminology cross-sectional, retrospective and prospective is usually used in the context of the beginning of the study and the direction of my follow-up, either no follow-up, forward looking or backward looking, right? So this is the meaning of this terminology. So we have seen the explanation for various terminologies. The last set of terms we need to have a very clear understanding are cohort study versus case control study. There's only one point you need to remember In a cohort study, the study groups are categorized based on the exposure, exposed and non-exposed groups. Then you will try to look at how many of the exposed group are developing the outcome and not developing the outcome, and how many of the non-exposed group are developing the outcome and not developing the outcome. Then you will try to draw conclusions based on that. So in a cohort study, the study groups which are recruited into the study are based on the exposure, exposed and non-exposed. Whereas in a case of case control study, the study groups which you are recruiting are based on the presence or absence of a disease or an outcome. So one group will be diseased or the cases, another group will be the controls or healthy people, and then you will be looking at how many of these people in cases and controls are having the exposure or not having the exposure. This is the key distinction. The key term you need to remember is study groups are based on exposed or non-exposed in case of cohort study. Study groups are based on the presence or absence of a disease or outcome in case of case control study. So case control and cohort terminology has got nothing to do with the direction of the study. So don't mix up these two terms with the prospective and retrospective. Once we are clear about the terminology, then we are ready to begin our journey to write an appropriate study design. Our journey begins with our first question. Are you assessing diagnostic accuracy of a test in your study? If yes, this is called a diagnostic accuracy study. Usually the diagnostic accuracy study, the outcomes are reported in terms of sensitivity, specificity, predictive values, and there is something called area under the curve. We'll discuss about them in detail later. But yes, if you are assessing diagnostic accuracy of a test, for example, I want to see whether mammography is as good as histopathology examination. I want to see whether my X-ray is as good as a CT or MRI in diagnosing knee joint injuries. So a screening test and a definitive test, and you are trying to compare how good is this screening test as compared to the gold standard or a more complicated test. This is called diagnostic accuracy studies. If you are not doing it, then time to ask the second question. Are you doing any intervention as a part of your study? If you are giving a tablet, doing a surgery, giving an injection, or giving a health advice, or changing the behavior of the person, yes, you are doing an intervention. So this particular group is called experimental studies or interventional studies. If you are simply observing things, allowing them to have their own course of action, then it is called observational studies. The next question to ask is, am I having a single group or am I having more than one group in my study? So in case of experimental studies, if you have a single group, that means you are taking a group of people, you are delivering some intervention, and you are measuring some parameter before and after the intervention. These are called before and after intervention studies, or sometimes called as interventional case series. So in case of experimental studies with more than two groups, usually we need to ask a question whether these two groups, the subjects are randomly being assigned to these two groups, or we are not following any random method. If we are randomly assigning the subjects to these two intervention groups or more than two intervention groups, it is called randomized control trial. And if we are not following any of these randomization procedures, they are called non-randomized control trials. So in both the groups, the subsequent procedures will open up, that is blinding, allocation, concealment. We'll discuss about them in detail in our video on experimental studies. In case of observational studies, if you have only one group, you call them as descriptive studies. If you have more than one group, you call it as analytical studies. So I have already explained, descriptive means one group, analytical means two groups or more than two groups. Then the next question is, you need to ask about what is the direction of my study. I'm starting my study now. I'm not following them forward or backward. I'm doing all the assessment instantaneously. That is called a cross-sectional study. I'm starting my study now in 2020. My outcomes have already occurred. I'm following the patients backward in time. I'm looking at the events which had happened in the past. That is a retrospective study. I'm starting my study in 2020. I'm waiting for my outcome to happen in some future, maybe after a year, 5 years or 10 years. That is called a prospective study. The final question to ask is, what are my study groups based on? If your study groups are based on the risk factor, then they are called cohort studies. If your study groups are based on the disease or no disease, then they are called case control studies. So So this is the simple algorithmic approach. We'll be explaining these concepts with the examples in our subsequent videos. If you want to master the skill of writing a good study design and thoroughly understand what are the pros and cons of choosing different study designs, you can log into our practical research lessons, PRL, and you can go out becoming an expert in writing study designs. So this was the simple algorithm to write basic study designs, but there are a lot of other study designs like correlational studies, otherwise called as ecological studies. There are other designs like nested case control study, cluster randomized trials. These are much more complicated study designs. We'll discuss about them in our future videos, our level 2 video on study designs. But as of now, this is the simple algorithm. Having a good companion is vital for a smooth and enjoyable research journey. Even though you have so many tools available in the market for research, the journey with CoGuide is very simple, fun and exciting, of high scientific standards, and can have real boost on your research career and also your clinical practice. So what are you waiting for? Log into CoGuide.in today. Invite all your friends and colleagues. Keep abreast with all the biomedical research developments across the globe by logging onto our social media platforms. Have an enjoyable research journey. Thank you so much.